Would you please stand and join us as we sing Amazing Grace?
10,000 years. Amen? Yeah, that'd be just the beginning. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Let us pray. O God, the Lord of life, the conqueror of death, our help in every time of trouble, who dost not willingly grieve or afflict the children of men, comfort us who mourn and give us grace in the presence of death to worship Thee, that we may have sure hope of eternal life and be enabled to put our whole trust in Thy goodness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You know, I don't hardly feel like I need to go through family stuff. We've already done everything. Isn't that fun to see yourself up there when you're little bitty? and all those things. We are here this day to honor and to celebrate the life of Hildred McCain Porter. She was 95 years old when she passed away. She would have been 96 this year. She passed away at Vanderbilt Medical Center. But, you know, I think her heart was here. I think her heart was here in Lexington. She lived here almost all of her life, 66 years in the same house. Wow, isn't that wonderful? I mean, that's longer than a lot of us have been alive. She's in that same house. Her children are here. Robert's here. Norma Jean is here. Her husband, Donald. They're her grandchildren, Angela and Barry. Her brother, Donald McCain, is from Tuscumbia. He's still in this area. This is a homecoming. It's a homecoming. Now, normally homecoming at the church is the fourth Sunday in September? Isn't that right? But today's a homecoming. It's a homecoming for a faithful church member. We have gathered here today to offer hope for her life, to lift her unto God Almighty, and to comfort her family. We are here today because she has lived a life of devotion to God. We are here today to affirm that she's gone home, not just to Lexington, but home to God. You know, the Lord gave us the Bible to be a comfort and a strength for us. And oftentimes I read the 23rd Psalm right here. But I'm not going to read the 23rd Psalm today. I'm going to skip over and read from Proverbs chapter 31. I think you'll know this passage. Let me share this with you. A capable woman who can find? She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not harm all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and works with the willing hands. She is like the ships of the merchant. She brings her food from far away. She rises while it's still night and provides food for her household and task for her servant girls. She considers a field and buys it. With the fruit of her hands, she plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and makes her arms strong. She perceives that her merchandise is profitable. Her lamp does not go out at night. She puts her hands to the distaff and her hands hold the spindle. She opens her hand to the poor and reaches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid for her household when it snows, for all her household are clothed in crimson. She makes herself coverings. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the city gates and taking his seat among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them. She supplies the merchant with sashes. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up early and call her happy. Her husband, too, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her a share in the fruit of her hands, and let her works praise her in the city gates. This has been the reading of God's Word. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank You for the life of Hildred Porter. We thank You, gracious God, for the joy with which she faced life. We thank You for her devotion to You through Christ Jesus our Savior, a devotion that has lasted almost all of her life. Father, we praise You that Christ Jesus comes to claim His own, and we trust, dear Lord, that He has come to claim His own, bringing her safely to be with You in heaven, where she is made perfect, completely restored to, in the image of our Savior Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank You for that. And we ask in the midst of our pain and in our grief, dear God, that You would send Your presence to be with us, to comfort us, and to strengthen us. Father, we can't face trials like this without You. Lord, help us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
What Mary is going to do today is a special request of Miss Hildred's. When she was still able to come to church here, she told me many times how much she liked a good uplifting song from the choir. So she had told Robert that she wanted this song done. So we feel honored to be able to do it for her celebration of life today.
Country.
Somebody will say, amen. Thank you, choir. Don't you know she's smiling? Don't you know she's enjoying this? Hallelujah. I'd like to share with you a passage of Scripture taken from John chapter 14. It's one of my favorite passages. I'm sure you know this by heart. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know that? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. Henceforth you know him and have seen him. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. This has been the reading of God's Word. Thanks be to God. One of the measures of integrity is how well you handle adversity. I believe Hildred scores 105 on handling difficult transitions. My 11-year-old comes home with 105 on spelling test. You can make 105, and I think she would. Now, I currently have a 90-year-old lady in my church who needs to be in assisted living or maybe in a nursing home. She has no children and expects, or maybe I should say demands, that people come by and take care of her. And we try. The only way she'll leave her house is when the funeral director comes by and takes her away. But not Hildred. Her attitude is, if you live old, to be old enough, you have to make some changes. In October 2002, she went to Robert's house for a doctor's appointment. She stayed that week, and when he got ready to take her back, she said, I can't go back. I'll have to do this all over again if I do. Later, she confided that she'd stayed in her home probably 1 year too long. Now, if I mentioned to you, that was 66 years. 66 years. I'm only 52. Did you get that? Only 52. I was her pastor then, and I remember going out to that house to visit with her, and it was fun seeing those slides up on the screen. She's lived there longer than many of us have been alive, but she was ready to go when it was time for her to go. And we were always looking for trips with the senior citizens here at the church, and one of the places we went was to go and see her after she had moved to Franklin, Tennessee. Seems like to me there were a lot of us, and I got to sit on the floor. I was proud to be able to be at the point where I could sit on the floor and get up. It was great. I tell you where I think she got the strength of character to face the changes that were necessary in her life. I believe it was firmly founded in her faith. Her daddy was a Cumberland Presbyterian minister, and she was raised in church. Now, preachers move around. We get the opportunity to do that. And when her daddy was serving in Allsboro, she was converted and joined the church. And she remembered that special night when her mother came down and kissed her on the side of her neck. Now, I think this is right, Robert. Isn't your grandfather the second person buried in the Nebo Cemetery? Is that right? Okay. I might have that wrong, but he's one of the early folks down there. When God is in the center of your life, then you have the strength to face whatever comes your way, and not to face it grudgingly, but with a smile and with integrity and with comfort. Now, one place she lived as a child was 4 miles away from school, and she had to walk 4 miles to school and then 4 miles back. Now, she didn't complain about that. It wasn't awful. It was an opportunity to play with her friends, to see folks on the way, to observe things. But I have to tell you, I believe on cold days like today, it would have been tough. You know, they didn't let women wear pants back then. She'd have been in a dress. She married J.D. in 1936, and they settled on the Porter Farm. She joined this church and has been a member here for 72 years. 72 years. Norma Jean and Robert grew up here. There was never any question where they were going to be on Sunday. You know, some people go home and wonder, well, are we going to church today? Mm-mm. They were here. This is where they were going to be. She believed in honoring the Sabbath and keeping it holy. Robert said, one Sunday afternoon, I asked her if she wanted to go see a movie. And she said, it's Sunday. We're not going to do that. Hey, you know, we still go out to eat. We don't do those things. Perhaps she has a better idea than we do. She loved this church, and she loved this choir. Robert said that when his daddy died, that he got a quartet to sing. And if you're in that quartet today, you did a great job. And she said that was nice. But she said, if the choir's good enough to sing on Sunday morning, then they're good enough to sing at my funeral. And that's what I want when my day comes. Now, hey, I used to be a part of this choir. Now I get choked up because I'm proud that she loved her choir and she loved her church and she honored God here. I'm telling you, we make a difference in the world beginning in the local church. That's where the work of Christ Jesus takes place. She was always complimenting of the choir. I'm so thankful. You know, I know that. I started to get up there and sing with you guys. Of all the things she liked to do the most on the farm, it was gardening. You know, she wasn't trying to get out of work. She enjoyed it. Now, Norma Jean said she could remember her getting up early in the morning and going to till or gather fruit or gather vegetables. You know, when you grew up in their family, you grew up shelling peas, husking corn, and stringing beans. And if others came around to help, well, she went in the kitchen and she had a meal prepared when they were finishing up the work. When the children came home to visit, she loaded them down with stuff out of the freezer to take back with them. You know, there's nothing any better. You can always tell at the church when somebody's got corn that they grew in their garden. You know, it just tastes better. I know Del Monte and Jolly Green Giant try, but there's nothing like the home stuff. When Hildred got older and couldn't do some of the things she liked, people from the church would come by and break up that garden for her and get it ready so she could plant. That's what a church family is. It's a family that takes care of each other. It was hard on her when J.D. died. She struggled for several long and lonesome and sad months. But on her second Christmas, after his death, the kids came home to find her smiling and happy. And you know, normally Christmas is such a very difficult time when you've lost a family member. But you know what made the difference in her sadness? She had baked sourdough bread, and she'd baked fruit bread, and she'd gotten homemade jam, and she'd taken that out and shared it. She'd shared it with friends and folks in the community. And that made her feel good. Now, I don't know what it did for her friends and stuff. I'm sure it made them feel good too. But Jesus reminded us that we are to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Healing came for her as she took care of other people. She loved herself by loving her neighbor. She was a great wife, a great mother, and a great grandmother. Her grandchildren didn't live close by, but when they came, it was special. Now, look at here. I'm jealous. She made blackberry or strawberry pie. Is there anything any better? I just want to know. Barry was handy at fixing things around the house for her, and Angela gave her a grandmother memory book. Now, I'm going to tell you, if you gave me a granddaddy memory book, it'd probably be sitting over there in the corner, you know, and I'd look at it and think, that's a nice book and somebody ought to put a picture in it. But you know what Angela got for Christmas the next year? She got that book filled up. And the last page was a poem that Hildred had written, especially for her. She touched lives as a school teacher. As a postal clerk, I noticed that she retired as a postal clerk the same year I graduated from college. She was a Sunday school teacher, a youth leader, and she was a friend. I think it was the teacher in her maybe that helped her enjoy that memory book so much. She let her faith influence each of these relationships. Sometimes when people that she loved strayed from the path she thought that they should be on, she never had a condemning word. She believed in getting her message out by the way she lived her life. She told Robert several times, "Son, I just try to be their friend and hope the way I live might help them in some way." That's a good attitude, isn't it? It's a good way to be. Recently, an eighth grade girl from Franklin, Tennessee, interviewed her for a school project. And when the project was completed, she had given Hildred a copy of the booklet that she had made. And one of the questions in this booklet is, "How do you want to be remembered?" What do you think she said? She said, "I want to be remembered as a Christian lady." As a Christian lady. And I believe that's what we're doing here today. We're remembering her as a Christian lady. Hildred has lived a long and blessed life. However, she has been in and out of the hospital some in her later years. Robert said, on one trip to the doctor came in and started talking to her about living wills. She already had one, but the doctor didn't know it. He informed her that she should start thinking about having a living will, especially at her age. And she looked at Dr. in the eye and said, "Man, you don't have to be my age to need a living will. You need one too. Something could happen to you that you need to have it." The doctor said, "Well, I don't guess we'll be talking about that anymore today." I believe much more important than a living will is being at peace with God. And if you don't know Jesus is the way and the truth and the life, then a living will is the least of the things that you have to worry about. Hildred took care of that a long time ago, and she continued in that faithful living with God all her days. Her mind was sharp up to the very end. She was talking and communicating with people Wednesday evening. In the wee hours of Friday morning, I don't believe she was surprised when the Lord Jesus Christ came to her at Vanderbilt Hospital and said, "Hildred, it's time to go." Now, in my mind, I just see her coming in and taking her by the hand. In a letter she had written to Norma Jean and Robert, she said, "The Lord has abundantly blessed me with a long life and gave me strength to face many things. So there's a reward, as He promises, for all who will try to obey His will." I believe as Jesus came, He took her to that reward. Taking her by the hand, I see Him just walk right through the wall of the hospital and straight into heaven. He had come to fulfill the scripture, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms or mansions. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way where I'm going." We know Hildred knew the way. We know that. I see a bright smile come across her face as she left with Jesus. I see them pause at the fountain of the water of life. How many times do you think she's taken a dipper and put it in a bucket to get some water? And I see Jesus pausing, taking the dipper and reaching into that fountain and given her a drink. And she is made new, perfect, and whole in the image of our Savior Jesus Christ. In Revelation 21, God says from the throne, "Behold, I make all things new." And He did. Don Piper, the author of 90 Minutes in Heaven, came to my church a couple of years ago. He said there's a welcoming committee of people who greet you when you get to heaven. People that have loved you and influenced you in your walk with Christ. I see J.D. there, and I see her daddy, Reverend Robert McCain, and her mother, Irene McCain. I see her brothers and sisters who have already gone before her, two brothers and two sisters. Who else would be there? Carmack, maybe? Think he'd be up there welcoming her, greeting her? There'd be a host of people, a host of people there to welcome her home. And though I think the choir here is great, I just imagine the smile on her face as she hears that heavenly choir singing praises to God as He is seated on the throne. There's room in that choir too for her if she would like. Hey, up there even Bobby McGuire would sound good. Hildred has lived her life in faithfulness to God. We don't have to worry about her because we know she is safe in heaven. There's no doubt. But what about us? We have the pain of her death. And we can't ask for God to take it away. That would deny the love that's been shared with her. And we simply can't do that. We want to remember these words that are recorded in John 14. If you love me, Jesus said, you'll keep my commandments. And I'll ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate, counselor, to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth. And we can trust that Jesus will send that loving presence of the Holy Spirit to enfold you and to comfort you and to strengthen you. Lean on God. In Revelation 21, it also says, behold, the dwelling of God is with people. He will be their God and they will be His peoples, and God Himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the former things have passed away. Let God enfold you in His mighty arms. Cry into His powerful shoulder. Let Him send loved friends to help comfort you and to console you and to hug you and to pray with you. Death is a part of life, but we know that death in Christ Jesus is a new beginning. We take comfort in that. Hildred's last advice to us is this: be good and live a life that can bless you all and those whose life you may touch along the way. If we do that, then we'll see her in that welcoming committee as we are being greeted into heaven. Jesus said, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Receive of that peace through Christ Jesus our Lord. Hildred is safe in God's love, and we are too. Let us pray. Gracious God, what a wonderful homecoming for Hildred McCain Porter. What a wonderful life, Lord, that she has led. I just can't imagine how many people are greeting her as she comes to the pearly gates of heaven and is welcomed by our blessed Savior and by the heavenly host. Father, thank You for her life. Thank You for her devotion to You. And thank You for the guide that she has been and the example that she has set of a life in Jesus Christ. Father, help us to live such a life so that when our time comes, we might join her and You in heaven. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.